You have no running water, you have no electricity, you have no inventory, you have no name. Like, you're not going to be open for Christmas. And I was like, yeah, I will. And he's like, I bet you $20,000 in sponsorship you won't be. I'm like, fine, game on. Why the heck is no one trying new business models in the physical world?
Right.
We were heat mapping the store. We had these things called live human beings who worked in the store. Why is it that tech companies get to launch in beta? Like, why can't I launch in beta? Like, people know what beta is.
Hey there, I'm Josh Golden, and this is Eureka, where we talk about big ideas and how they came to be. Today on the show, we have Rachel Shechtman, who is the founder of the retail store Story. Amazingly, Story every 8 weeks would flip its theme, its products, and entire experience. Unbelievable story. I cannot wait to hear what she has to say. I want to thank Verizon Media for being a proud supporter of Eureka. As an incubator of innovation and next-gen content, Verizon Media's trusted media ecosystem of premium brands like Yahoo and TechCrunch help consumers, advertisers, and media partners stay informed, entertained, and connected. Ladies and gentlemen, I want to welcome Rachel Shechtman, the founder of the store Story, to the show Eureka. Rachel, thank you so much for joining me today.
Thank you for having me.
I know, look at us, we're like talking
in
person.
I know, no mask, post-pandemic, I can hug you.
Yes, and actually, you are my sixth hug. I'm counting people I'm hugging.
I'm putting that on my LinkedIn profile. Josh Golden,
six hug. Yeah, being in person with people is, it's my oxygen.
Yeah.
I didn't realize how sad I was for a while.
I'm with you. I walked down the street like,
hi.
You would have think I had five cocktails constantly like skipping and smiling because I'm like, people, we can talk and hug.
Oh God, it's so important. Thank you. Thank you for coming in
and doing this with me. Of course, thank you for having me.
Before I jump in to your Eureka moment, I like to sort of set the stage a teeny bit. Many times when people come up with a big idea or an inspiration, they might have a vocal utterance.
Yeah.
Mine is a little more boring, but when you have a moment of like, wow, that's a great idea, what is the thing that you say?
There's like two, it's like a, I mean, nothing with me is simple, right? So it's a two-step process. Like, so if we're talking and I have an idea, I'm like, oh my gosh. So there's like a moment, right? There's like, oh my gosh. And then I'm like, and then I say to you, is it okay if I get up and pace? Because like, I do my best thinking when I'm pacing. So like oftentimes like on the phone, I'm like on the phone going back and forth. So it's a two-part thing. It's like, oh my gosh, I just had a thought. And then I'm like, wait, I gotta get up and pace. And then I pace. So that's how that goes down.
Rachel, I've asked this question to so many people now. That is a great answer. Oh my gosh, but it's not just oh my gosh, it's oh my gosh.
No,
and you grab your knees.
There's choreography, I mean, there's like everything.
Thinking about yourself in your most creative space, what activity are you doing when you're like, I'm the most creative when I am?
I'm most creative when walking a trade show.
Wow.
I bet no one said that one. And that's not what I was going to say. I was going to say shopping or hanging with friends. But like, no, when I really think about, like, now let's be clear. Because like,
yeah, we
maybe
have to set
people
context.
Listening or watching are like, is she talking about CES? No.
No, okay.
But
so let's
like,
be clear. It's a certain trade
I mean, no
show.
Disrespect to CES.
No.
At all.
Can be cool.
No, what I'm talking about is like when I was 12 years old, mm-hmm. my mom took me to the Jacob Javits Center. To the New York gift show.
Oh my God, I was gonna just say gift show. I'm
yeah.
like, I'm such a
gift
fan.
Show.
The gift
and
show, the
like,
toy fair is also really
yeah,
good though,
Yeah, the toy
too.
Fair is great too. For my bat mitzvah favors wholesale, like every 12-year-old, of course.
wait. Your mother's like, I know. Rachel, we're gonna go and figure out which amazing-
What favors they should be. Well, in all fairness, so I'm four generations of retail, so there's no escaping that. And she was going for her business. So she was she trained with Giorgio and Joel when they started Dean and DeLuca. So she had a gourmet food store in West Hartford, Connecticut that also had like, you mm-hmm. know, gifts and whatnot. Anyways, so she was going for her store and she thought, oh, let me bring my kid who likes to shop. And my mom's really not a shopper, which is funny. And, you know, maybe she'll like have ideas for her bat mitzvah. And I would like find all these cool things. I was like, this is a job? You can shop for a living? Like, sign me up. So, no, but like fast forward. When I think about it is whether it's going to Coterie, which is like women's accessories and fashion, or the New York Gift Show, or Maison Objet in Paris is probably my favorite trade show. It literally I'm trying to think, I'm not like wearing anything today, but like, there might be like a color of a bracelet done in a different way, and there's like one thing that I become obsessed with, and then that begins, like, that's the first thing on my mental Pinterest board that I then build everything around.
That's fast. So you use a singular inspiration as you're walking through. That's fascinating.
It's usually one item.
But other people, for example, have answered like running or brushing my teeth or in the shower. You're like, trade show. But
that's not even what I was going to say. I was going to say shopping or dinner with friends, but it's trade show.
Trade show it is. So tell me, let's go into the moment where you actually were, where you had that moment of like, I think I can make a store that's going to be different.
The aha moment that kind of led to the creation of Story was kind of twofold. It was two different things. It was one, you know, it was 2011, like the moment where I actually pulled the trigger. And there was all this reinvention happening online. You had new business models, new platforms. You had crowdfunding. You had crowdsourcing. You had companies like Birchbox, like subscription retail, right? But like, well, there's these new business models. And that's giving way to new consumer behavior,
right?
And new consumer expectations. And we're the same people who live online who live offline. So why the heck is no one trying new business models in the physical world?
Right.
So it was kind of more, it was a process over time. Like, sadly, I must confess, there's no business plan that I could show you. There's like maybe like thousands of random scraps of paper, like the back of like, you know, a Con Edison bill or something that had a note. There was no business plan. And then what happened was I was just like, oh, okay. And like, you know, we're all used to getting new content every half a second on our phone. Like, why the heck do stores look the same every few months? Like, that makes no sense. And then Blake Mikowski, who founded Tom's Shoes, I'd done a big partnership between him and Microsoft. And when we were in Seattle together, and we were driving to, I remember we were in the back of the car. I remember exactly, like, he was on the right, I was on the left. And we were driving to the airport. And I was like, blah, 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 like talking about my random idea. And, oh, yeah, imagine this new retail store. And he's like, enough with the someday shit. Can I say shit?
Yes, you can say shit.
I normally, like, say that's not what I said. But that's what, you know. So he said, enough with the someday shit. Just shut up and do it. Like, you keep on saying someday. You spent 10 years doing it for everyone else. Like, do it for yourself. And literally, I think it was like 6 weeks to the day of being in the back of the car with him, I signed the lease.
Wow. 6 weeks. So you were able to, you had enough of
I had the idea
already nailed.
Yeah.
There was no like, I don't know exactly how we do this. You know
And I'm like, oh, well, I have some like, I'm consulting and maybe, you know, a couple friends lent me money. And I was like, yeah, I'll just like sign the lease and, you know.
How bad could it be?
Yeah. I mean, I told myself if it's profitable within a year, which is like very uncommon in retail, then I'll consider it a success. And I guess this is like my new job. And if it's not profitable, it was a great experiment. And like, that's how I think of everything I do as an experiment. So, you know, I guess I don't have to knock on wood anymore because it already happened.
Oh, okay, fine. Yeah, it did happen.
But yeah, we were profitable.
Oh my God, that's awesome. Tell me about the first story. How story
Well, first
works.
Say what story is.
Yes. Say what. Let's. What is? And what
then,
is it?
And then I'll throw you a twist and tell you.
I'm ready.
And tell you the first story wasn't even called Story. So
the
concept behind Story is a space that has the point of view of a magazine. We reinvent it entirely like a gallery and sell things like a store. So everything always changes. And, you know, if a magazine tells stories by writing articles and taking pictures, our version of narrative storytelling is curating merchandise around a subject matter and then having events that bring it to life. So if it was like wellness story, right, we might sell everything from yoga mats to healthy cookbooks to heart rate monitors. And then we might do like Matt Pilates on the weekend or a panel on, you know, holistic health or whatever. But the second part, so that's kind of the consumer experience.
Sure.
But like magazines also have this thing called advertising.
Right.
And we had sponsorship. So what was, you know, unique at the time for retail was having not, you know, two revenue streams. So we didn't just make money by selling products.
Right.
But like Cigna, for example, health insurance, sponsored wellness story. So when you think about it, right, they get access to a new channel for, you know, one of a myriad of different reasons.
To sell their brand story, effectively.
Yeah, or depending on, you know, in the case of Cigna, right, like I'm one store on 10th Avenue and 19th Street, right? And we're talking about like six figures, decent yeah. sized budget and ad buys here. For them, it was a living lab. So it was like a live focus group.
Oh, interesting.
So for them, we were capturing insights that could inform a potential different
campaign
retail strategy
effort,
for
right.
them.
Interesting.
So what we could do in 6 weeks would have probably taken much longer period of time. And instead of like sitting in a focus group in a room saying, what would you buy? What do you think you would do? We actually, we were
would
heat mapping the store. We had these things called live human beings who worked in the store. you know, they observed things, they engaged with people. And then there was this like, you know, massive report that went back to Cigna with all this data that would inform different decisions they would ultimately make.
You were saying the first moment, the first story
yeah.
wasn't called story.
No, so a lot of people don't know this story. And it's,
oh my God, I love it.
And so, but I, you know, anyone who's intrigued by it, you could actually Google, you know, this article in Fast Company, which is the punchline at the end of the story, which I'll mention. But basically, Ben Kaufman is one of my best friends, mm-hmm. and he's the founder of Camp, which is a family experience brand, and I'm on the board and do a bunch of stuff with them. And so when at the time he had a company called Quirky, which was all about making invention accessible, and you'd have an idea for a product and they'd make it. Anyways, long story short, I signed a lease like October 28th, 2011. I'm talking to Ben as I normally do, and being like, oh my God, I'm so excited for Christmas. And he's like, what the hell are you talking about? You have no running water, you have no electricity, you have no inventory, you have no name, like you're not gonna be open for Christmas. And I was like, yeah, I will. And he's like, I bet you $20,000 in sponsorship you won't be. And like, I'm like, fine, game on, right? And like Ben wins at everything. So I'm like—
Risk.
Okay, so well, the good news is I didn't have to pay him $20,000,
okay.
So like, the bet was like, if I actually made it, he would be one of the brands in story.
Yeah.
And if I didn't, like he just got to gloat for the rest of our friendship at like how much smarter he is than me, which he is. So I'm like, okay, game on. And I was like, all I care about is beating Ben. Like more than, like, it was almost more important than whether or not the business even worked, right? I was just like, I have to win. And like one night after like, I'm sure a couple glasses of wine, I didn't have the trademark on story. So I wasn't gonna use the name yet. And I had no inventory. And I was like, back to kind of what I said earlier, if we're the same people who live online, who live offline, why is it that tech companies get to launch in beta? Like, why can't I launch in beta? Like, people know what beta is. And so we called ourselves a startup store beta. And we only sold products from startups. And so this was pre Warby Parker having a store or yeah. any D2C brands having stores. So we had Birchbox, we had Bauble Bar, we had Quirky, we had Art Space, and they were physical expressions of these online brands.
In the store.
And then guess what happens? When you open said store on December 1st at 4:32 p.m. and beat your friend Ben, in addition to feeling very proud, what ends up happening is all the other people in the store, they have big, long email lists. So then they email their customers and saying,
oh,
hey, we have a store.
Oh,
and
God,
so like
fun.
Within a week, there's millions and millions and millions of media impressions. The headline on the Fast Company article is, can a startup store reinvent retail? I'm like, reinvent retail? I was trying to win a bet. Like, what are you talking about? There's a fun like time lapse of the store being done. But like, yeah, before story was ever story, no one knows this. It was a startup store beta, which was my way to like work out the kinks and win a bet before I opened on February 1st, 2012.
Oh my God, that is so great. Was there a moment where you're like, oh my God, this is actually gonna work?
Yeah, I mean, there were a couple different moments. I mean, when I actually knew it was gonna work was like when I stood up on the stage at the National Retail Federation annual conference giving a keynote speech to a couple thousand people in that massive room. And I said we were profitable. Because to me, like, you can't argue with numbers. Like, 1 + 1 = 2. Like, that's just fact, right? And so, someone could like my idea, not like my idea. Someone could say it was smart, someone could say it was stupid, right? There's lots of different ways people could digest what I was doing.
Right.
But if it was profitable, you couldn't argue with that. It's profitable. Again, it doesn't mean people have to like it. So that to me was when I knew it would work. But I think one of the big moments was Beth Comstock, who's a good friend of mine. And at the
yes.
time,
She's fabulous. I had the benefit of working with her when I was at NBC. She was awesome to work with.
She's a very special human. And at the time, she was chief marketing officer of GE. And one of her many superpowers is she has an uncanny ability. She really just like trusts her gut and doesn't wait for, you know, to read an article about a trend or to hear about a new agency that someone else hired. She's the one doing that, right? Mm. Like, and like, again, I didn't even have like a signed lease or a business plan when I bumped into her on the street and told her about Story. And she took a chance. And in October of 2012, so before the 1 year mark, she sponsored Making Things Story.
And with GE. Yeah.
And so we had a CNC mill and 3D printers. And there was a moment in that store where you had people all around these MakerBot 3D printers. I had someone in the window working with a wood lathe making candlesticks. And the store was just like humming. And it was packed. And there was like 6-year-olds and 15-year-olds. And there were middle-aged men and like, you know, millennial women. And there was every walk of life, every age. And I was like, oh, I actually think this can work. That was it.
Oh my God, that's such a great moment. Beth gave you such a gift.
She's given me many gifts, but yeah, that was the biggest.
To have someone believe in you without having any evidence, it's extraordinary. Those people are very, very special that are like willing to extend. They're like, I don't know, but I'm going to go with you on this one. How did Pitch Night come to exist?
We started this thing called Pitch Night because we were getting pitched so many products, I didn't have time to see them all.
You were using it as your way to be like,
yeah,
let me.
It was a complete accident.
I thought it was for the audience that they're.
No, there was no audience or anything. It was a complete accident. It was to solve a business problem. So I looked at my sister and I was like, you know, my favorite part is like seeing all the products, but there was so much being sent in, I couldn't see it all. So I'm like, let's just have these people come for a night and pitch a product. And then what was kind of cool about Pitch Night is like, it was, you couldn't watch it. You only could come to Pitch Night if you were a maker or small business pitching a product. And then what we did was, I was like, you know what? I'm one store on 10th Avenue and 19th. We didn't even sell online. Mm. And so I'm like, I don't want them just coming for me. So I would always bring in a national retailer and a member of the media. So Adam Glassman from Oprah Magazine, who does the O-List, was a repeat offender on the panel with me. But we had everyone from like the CEO of Bloomingdale's to West Elm to Mindy Grossman, who was at HSN at the time. Mm-hmm. And the only criteria was you had to have a ready-made product to sell. It couldn't be a prototype or an idea. And you couldn't have pitched me or anyone on the panel. So that means if you just RSVP'd straight fast enough, you could be face-to-face with Mindy Grossman and Adam Glassman
and
like me.
What a great idea.
You had 2 minutes to pitch. And
it was a hard 2 minutes.
It was a hard 2 minutes. And what was special was like even the people there pitching couldn't watch each other. So the value proposition was access, not outcome, but it also became a community night. So everyone had a name tag saying, hi, I'm Rachel, I make chocolate. And then it's like, hi, Josh, you know, you make jewelry. And we'd be like, oh, cool, let's make chocolate jewelry. And so, you know, and we'd get PBR. So everyone's like drinking PBR out of a can, hanging out with each other.
Super cheap.
And one by one come up and pitch.
Oh my God, that sounds so fun.
It was my favorite thing.
Was it your favorite thing?
Hands down.
One of the other major themes that I try to cover and want to make certain I capture is, and you kind of touched on it moments ago, but what assumptions did you have to overcome that everyone was like, well, that'll never work? What assumptions? There were certain key assumptions that you're like, that you were like, I'm ignoring those.
Yeah.
Can you share with those about
story? There were lots of assumptions. I mean, especially on the traditional retail side of things, right? Like, because, you know, retail stores have one metric of success, which is sales per square foot. And, you know, our price point, our SKU density, all of that was variable depending on what the theme
like if
was.
If you have a pot making or a
right.
you know,
if plant, I were
plant,
like,
making
plant
section,
making studio, right?
Like, it's like that's not going to be, it's gonna be less sales per square foot.
Exactly. You know, but then you have the sponsorship revenue, right? Which was anywhere from like $600,000 to $1 million, depending on the time of year. Mm. You know, not where we started, but that's, you know, where we landed our last year. So like some significant dollars. So, you know, it was kind of like in talking initially to people in the industry, and they'd be like, well, what's your margin? What's your sales per square foot? And I was like, my margin? And I was like, listen, this business isn't being made based on my margin on, you know, a plant. The other thing is we had to shut down the store. So like at any given time, the store was shut down for one to two weeks to turn over the whole store. Completely shut down. So not a dollar coming in the door.
That is a major assumption because like ordinarily it's like when is it open? It's not open these 2 weeks.
Yeah.
How did you, I wonder if that created a little bit of a supply and demand urge, like is it open yet? What's the next thing that's coming?
I think so. I mean, I think that there were, listen, I think there were people who came to specific stories because, you know, they might, you know, follow, you know, Bobby Brown, makeup artist, not right. musician. And she did stuff with Story. And, you know, if she posted she was at Story, people might come to that. And then there's other people who were like diehard annual subscribers who would come to every issue. And they'd come to everything. So, yeah.
I love how you still frame it as a magazine and an editorial experience, even though it was a retail, you know, expression.
Yeah. Well, I also think that, you know, we label these things based on industry, but like look at consumer behavior, right? Like buying off Instagram, that's not a store. So like if you're buying someone's shirt off Instagram that's from The Gap, are you buying from The Gap or are you buying from the influencer who you're shopping from on Instagram? And so I think it's, to me, it's more about creating businesses that react to how we live versus how industries talk about themselves.
Hi there, I'm here with Andrea Wasserman, the head of global commerce for Verizon Media. Andrea, thank you so much for joining me. Do you have a moment of eureka or an inspiration that you can share?
I've had many, but the one that always comes to mind first is actually quite a bit far back.
You go back as far as you want. Any moment counts.
Okay, well, we're going back to fourth grade here.
Oh, that's far back, yes. Okay, fourth grade, awesome. Tell me about it.
I was 10 years old. I walk onto the school bus. I was a really responsible child and was very upset to see that there were no seatbelts on the school bus.
That's a surprise. What was it with no seatbelts in the buses? That's nuts,
exactly.
Right?
Exactly. I mean, it was the 1980s. What can you expect?
Right. You'll be fine. Go to school.
Right.
You must have had a moment of fear, I guess, without seatbelts.
I did, and confusion. And it was this choice of, do I refuse to take the bus and kind of get a little rebellious? Do I get really upset about it? Do I just acquiesce? And my parents coached me to actually speak up and try to change the situation.
Oh my, did something happen?
It did. What did you? I banded together with other responsible children, started a petition, got the seatbelts installed, and had really safe rides to school.
Amazing. Well, what did that eureka moment teach you later in life?
It taught me that this choice we're often faced with of being either a rule breaker or a rule changer doesn't need to be so binary. And that really we can be rule changers and make situations work for us. And so this is something that I've applied in business, in life, and in all of the leadership work that I do.
Andrea, thank you so much for that story. What a great insight. I love it. Thank you so much, Andrea. Andrea Wasserman, the head of global commerce for Verizon Media. Thank you so much for joining the show.
Thanks, Josh.
Are you ready for your rapid fire questions, Rachel Shechtman?
I'm ready for my rapid fire.
Okay. Some of them are a little bit edgy, so just be prepared. Okay. I ripped this one off. What is your favorite curse word or phrase? Any language is fine.
Fuck.
Just straight up fuck. Just as a clean, is it like fuck? And that, when do you normally use the curse word?
You know, bumping into the corner of the coffee table or something.
Fuck. Yeah.
Is that?
Yeah. I think that's a good one. It's a very, you know, it's almost.
Sometimes it's like audible and sometimes like at lunch today, I said something I shouldn't have. And in my head, I'm like, fuck.
In your head only.
In my head only. But yeah.
Yeah. So tell me about a moment that you thought you might be dreaming, but it was actually real.
Okay. I have it. So, it was when Mayor Bloomberg did a press conference from Story. It was probably him doing.
You're like,
I don't know.
You're standing there watching, you're like, I cannot believe this is happening.
The mayor
in
of
my
New
store.
York is in my store. Like, who does a press conference from a retail store, let alone one on 10th Avenue
right.
that doesn't even have e-commerce?
Right.
I mean.
That is a good one. When is your time that you work best?
Night.
How late?
It depends, but night, anything like, I mean, like, I sometimes sadly get in a groove, like starting at like 6 o'clock. But I'm better at night than I am in the morning for sure.
What's your biggest habit that you feel has made you the most successful?
Probably being inquisitive, right? If you're walking down the street and you're wearing something, you know, instead of saying, oh, that's nice, I might be like, excuse me, where'd you get your shirt?
Do you do that?
I've been known to do that.
Oh, that's good.
But
Do people find it complimentary?
Well, it always is, right? Like, if I don't like it, I'm like, where'd you get your ugly shirt? Like, you know, I only would do it. Like, who doesn't want to be flattered, right? Like,
where'd you get your amazing shirt, right?
Where'd you get your amazing shirt? Like, who doesn't want to ask that question?
Awesome.
So I'm curious.
That's
so
awesome.
I think that's probably what it is.
Do you ever, this is not on the list, sorry. Did you ever not feel confident?
Yeah, like, I spent, like, up until, like, my amazing boyfriend, future person, whatever we call him.
Call him a future person. I like that. Future person. You're my future
person. Oh, I called him the other day my forever person because I was like, the word boyfriend sounds like I'm 12. Like, he's not my business partner. Like, you know, we will get married, but we're not married yet. So, like, the other day I called him my forever person. So
that's so nice. It's very romantic.
But before my forever person, I was like a thumb-sucking two-year-old on dates. Like, I out of my skin, nervous and insecure. Like, and I have lots of close guy friends who, like, find it comical because they're like, you have no problem walking up to Barack Obama in a theater, which I did do once.
Did security, and come and, like...
No, but, like, I won't sound like a douchebag and, like, drop a bunch of celebrity names, but, like, put a celebrity in front of me and who cares? Like, I'll talk to whomever. I don't care how famous they are. But, like, put me on a date? Forget about it. Like, I can't say two words. I'm out of my skin, insecure. Not anymore, because I have my future person. But I spent 40 years being that insecure person who couldn't date.
Oh, my God. So interesting. Thank you so much for joining me.
Thank you for having me.
You're welcome.